Our next speaker is Bert Hubert, who will guide us into some innovation he's been driving in the space of configurations. Apparently, there has been some changes since how we did it 40, 50 years ago with punching cards. I think this is the logical next step that Bert will share with us. Bert, the floor is yours.
Thank you. So I cannot top this. I have not as much IPv6. I have no Christmas tree, and I hope I can excite you with some configuration management now. At least the story starts nice. We had to adapt the presentation for this projector, which is not that great, or my presentation was not that good. If you want to actually read the slides, you might want to go to colmo.org on your phone, and then you can read the small letters. So colmo.org has a link to this presentation. I'll repeat that later if needed. So it starts out a very long time ago, 15 years ago, and I got a phone call from a friend of mine, and he said, well, we have this satellite network and nothing works, and all the official network engineers, the super duper network engineers, they cannot fix it, and we've given up. And Bert, can you maybe help? And I had no job at the time, so of course I was willing to help. So I went to Flevoland, which is where the network people were of the UNHCR mission in Bosnia. And Biddinghuizen. It is as lovely as it looks over here. And this is a small company over there. They're still there. They've been acquired 5 times now. And they have satellite dishes, and they do geostationary internet connections to places that have very bad connectivity. And they had a whopping 128 kilobit per second capacity and 500 milliseconds of latency. And it was in Biddinghuizen. And they had a big problem there. They had a United Nations mission. This is a presentation from 2002, so you can see that my presentation skills have gone down over time. At least I used more colors back then. And these people had 5 locations. They were interconnected with satellite links, and whenever someone used the internet, the VoIP would stop working. Whenever someone sent an email, both the VoIP and the internet would stop working. And this was a problem because they had a mission to coordinate. It was actually pretty important. So, and because they've tried everything else, they thought, well, let's... We found this guy on the internet, Bert, and he knows some stuff about Linux shaping and routing, so let's call him. So I came in, had a lot of fun there, and we removed all their Cisco cruft because they had layers and layers and layers of routers and stuff, and we put in 5 additional Linux machines which shaped the internet as far as it would go. So every packet was examined and studied. Every VoIP packet went to the front of every queue. We shaped it so that the horrible satellite modems, which had queues like this, I mean, buffer bloat is nothing new. They had it in 2001 as well. So we shaped everything until the satellite would never see more than 1 packet at a time. Cue this. And so we had a lot of fun with that. And finally, we ended up with 5 boxes doing full bidirectional shaping. And in the end, it was possible to actually do a phone call and try to use the webmail in Brussels. Of course, the phone call did work at that time. The webmail might take you maybe 15 minutes or something like that. So this was a great victory for the Linux nerd, because in 2001, Linux was still sort of shady. These were these Cisco people. They were really unhappy with me there. And I was feeling good. And then, of course, you know, it all breaks down. Because we'd been tweaking on these 5 Linux boxes for days to get all the queues just right and the bridge control and everything, because nothing could change, so it had all been bridge-based. So it was a very finicky configuration, and we changed Ethernet settings, we changed the queue lengths, we changed IP tables, you have bridge control in there. And at one point, these guys said, okay, Mr. Hotshot, your Linux machine is nice, can we get a copy of the configuration? And I don't know the actual configuration, because I've been typing away on this for 3 days, and no idea what I changed. It was a lot, I know that. A lot of stuff in /proc/sys and stuff. And they said, oh, wow, Mr. Linux. And they made a lot of fun of me. Of course, at that point, I reminded them that their network did not work at all. And then they said, well, okay, at least can you, because these servers are in Bosnia, the power there is not that great, there's an actual war going on, can you at least commit the configuration? I said, I can also not do that. If it reboots, everything is gone. It was a very fun meeting there. And so they said, well, so what can you do? Can you? I said, well, the one thing we could do is I know most of the configuration is somewhere on disk, so we could make a disk image and ship it over there, over the 128 kilobits per second connection. And they said, no, you would actually have to go there in an armored United Nations helicopter. And that got me very well motivated for solving the issue. So I'm not like that. So in the end, I worked pretty hard and I did not have to get into this helicopter. It would have worked though. But that got me thinking. It got me thinking, because this is now 15 years ago, and it got me thinking, how is it that these networking people have had the discipline, that they have devices that they can configure, and then actually say, store the configuration, or roll back even the configuration. Well, because in Linux, we changed all these things. We changed IP tables, the QLAN, proxies, you know, bridge control and stuff, the quality of service settings, the shaping, and all of these tools have pretty nice output, so I can say, show me your shaping configuration. I get a nice human readable display that says, this is how we shape. But I cannot feed that human readable output back into that same tool again and get the same result. So it's a one-way street. You configure the system will show you how it is configured, but it will never tell you what you did. And to this day, only IP tables, as far as I know, has addressed this. IP tables now has a sort of hacky script, IP tables save and IP tables restore. There you can do it, and it almost always works. But the other stuff still, to this day, if you've configured a nice, complicated bridging setup, then Linux is like, well, well done. So how have we addressed this? This is what people came up with some time ago. They said, well, we're going to make one central file, and you're going to put everything in that file, and it might be called /etc network interfaces or whatever, and that file will configure the rest of the system for you, and you will not ever touch the rest of the system again. Because the moment you change a setting manually in the routing table, it's gone. We'll never get it out. So either we create a file that does the whole thing, or we take a router daemon that does it for us, but it's a one-way street. There's the happy guy on the left, and by the way, I hate it really that in these presentation programs, there's always only a happy guy. Very often, I want to have an unhappy guy in a presentation, but someone over there said, no, presentations only have happy people. So, okay, this guy is not actually happy, by the way. So this is the one-way street that we have now. If we want to configure something complicated, we say we have one master file, you put the configuration in there, and then we make that master file generate all the configuration items, and if you ever touch one of those downstream items, you will no longer know what happened. That was 2000. These days, we've put yet another layer in front, because we see manually changing the networking interfaces file that is already too manual, so now we make a playbook that manipulates the networking file for you, that manipulates the daemons for you. And I'm pretty sure that in 2017, someone is already working on putting another layer in front of here. It's one, the playbook generator service. Is anyone already using a playbook generator service? Get on it. So this sucks. You can see this is a one-way street. The dream of automation, and by the way, and I love automation, especially when it works, and I really love it. I can compose stuff and wonderful. But this is the story. Yeah, we create a playbook, we configure our devices, they almost work, we tweak the playbook a little bit, and deploy to the servers and happiness. And especially afterwards, this is also how you remember that it went. What you do not remember is that this is the actual workflow. You create a playbook, play it to the server, nothing works. You inspect the server, you see that your playbook mangled a comment somewhere in the configuration file, which looked a lot like the line that you wanted to tweak, but now actually it's in a comment block, so nothing worked. Change the playbook, run it again, and you keep working over here in the playbook to get the server to do what you want. And once you're done, you run the whole playbook from a fresh server, and again it doesn't work. Because apparently there were some things that you fixed that did not get ported back into the playbook. So this is actually the part that you forget, the 10 hours of swearing. And afterwards, then you have something that is glorious, of course. So don't get me wrong, I'm fully in favor of automation. It's just the pain. The dream workflow is actually what I did for this United Nations project. You sit down, you tweak your server, you toy around with it until it's exactly as you like it. And then you say, now turn this server into a playbook. There are some tools that pretend to do it, but they don't. But this would be lovely. We say, okay, the server is right now, get me an instruction that gets me another one of these servers, and I can read through it and inspect if there are any mistakes in there, any configuration items that I didn't actually need in there. But this would be great. So this would be a two-way street. So I have a playbook that generates a server, but I can also generate a playbook from the server. Who would want this? I have not lost you yet. Okay. The challenging bits are still coming. So why is it hard? I think you know this. There are many configuration files lying around. I love the XIM email SMTP configuration file, which is actually most of the XIM code actually lives in the configuration file. Sort of embarrassing that they ship it in /etc. To the point that Debian contains an XIM configuration file generator which you can configure with a playbook. So this is actually a very hard problem. It's very difficult once you have made a piece of software to make it emit its configuration. And especially when the software itself may not even work without the configuration file, for example, because many of its components are actually defined in the configuration file. So we have lots of ways of configuring stuff, but we have no ways back. And instead, we end up with all kinds of Ansible modules or whatever automation system that sort of help us make these configuration files because it was too difficult for the authors of the service that we are attempting to configure to create an own API. The secret 2017 solution is that it's so hard to make a proper playbook that we write a playbook that simply copies out configuration files that are known to work. And how did we make that template? Well, we copied it from the previous server. That means that you get a sort of fake playbook that will only deploy to exactly that version of CentOS. Because you copied in all of the XIM configuration in there, or all of the postfix configuration. And this is a shortcut which sort of resolves the pain. So what happens here is you configure a server until it's as you like, and then you take most of /etc and put it in your playbook. And this is not actually what you want because we, as PowerDNS, we get lots of people that are stuck on very old versions of CentOS. And they cannot migrate because all their automation is actually locked into place. It only works on this specific server. This is the dream, what you would want. And this has been mangled a little bit because of the projector. What you would like to have are the red boxes. The red boxes say this is a web server. This is a called WS, that actually exists. And this web server would offer a programmatic configuration API. So if you want to provision a website called ds9a.nl, you would do the call add site, then the URL, and then where the actual files are stored. And next you might want to say, well, whenever someone comes in over HTTP, which is lame, we want to redirect them to HTTPS immediately. That's the middle red box. And finally, when you are done configuring the server, so when to configure the server, you make all kinds of API calls like add website, disable a directory listing, configure the SSL. After you're done configuring the server, you ask the server, can you get me a minimal copy of your configuration file? So not the full configuration file with 5,000 defaults in there, no. Get me a very small description that says, okay, server, give me a list of how you are configured so that if I give that list to another server, it will be configured in exactly the same way. And then once you have that minimal configuration file, you put it in your playbook. This is sort of a dream where you want to end up. And that's what I made. So I'm presenting an idea, which is always dangerous. It's far more fun to present an actual working Christmas tree. Because if you present an idea, people are like, yeah, I have many ideas in the shower, and many of these ideas don't actually work. So I made sure that I took this idea and I also implemented it, that it's concrete enough that you can play around with it and disagree with it. So what I've made is Colmo, the name, I will explain later why it's called that way. This is a library that gives you programmatic access to an API, sorry, to a configuration. So you have a configuration state and you can make API calls against it. Say, enable this website, disable that website. It creates a self-documenting configuration file.
A self-documenting configuration file.
So whenever I download a piece of software, I get a whole bunch of configuration, and in the middle it says timeout is 5,000. 5,000 what? And I have to troll the web, and I found it, well, up to version 1.2, that was milliseconds, and now it's seconds. PowerDNS did this, by the way. It was a lot of fun. What you also want to do is you actually want to be able to create a configuration file and have the API tell you that, no, this is not a valid configuration file. The change you are trying to make is not legit. I want it to stop it. And this can happen offline. So you can create a configuration file programmatically on your central provisioning server and then send that out. And this is all meant to ease automation. So not meant to replace automation. So what's the idea? The configuration schema file. If you take away one thing from this presentation, it's the configuration schema file. What does that mean? You get a piece of software, you want to use it, there is a schema that describes the configuration format. It says these are the things that go into the configuration file, this is what they mean, these are the defaults, these are the units. So when I have an item called client timeout and it says 5,000, it also says, by the way, that is milliseconds. Or when I have something called a bind address, then it says, well, you actually need to put an IPv6 address or an IPv4 address in there. So you get this schema file is already a great way of getting to know a new piece of software because it lists every configuration item there is and the default. And then there is a stored configuration file, which is a delta on what the schema defines. So the schema has all the defaults in there, like a web server might say, we bind to port 80 by default. And in the configuration file, it says, no, we bind to port 8000. And then there's a library. And this library is meant for all developers of software to get all this stuff without having to invent it. And the final two pieces are, there is a computer program called call control, which allows you to manipulate a configuration file. So you have a piece of software, you have the schema, and you have the configuration file, and if you want to make a change to the configuration file, you take the program call control, and you say set verbose is false, and it will happen. The really interesting thing is, libcolmo also allows you to do this at runtime. So you can talk to a running program and say, I want you to change the verbose setting. I will now show you some examples. I mentioned the schema, how nice it is. So it's type safe. If it has to be a Boolean, you must give it a Boolean. It's IPv4 address, it must be an IPv4 address. By the way, you cannot even pick an IPv4 address in the system now. You can only put in IPv6 or IPv4, even in the Netherlands. Every field is mandatory or optional. As a description, units, and constraints. If nothing else, if you don't use the rest of the system, this is a very nice set of documentation. So this is the little web server. It actually powers the colmo.org website called WS for web server. What does it look like? And this is where we can figure out if the screen... So we're going to try a little bit like this. Nope. Yeah. Okay. So in the top, it registers a variable called verbose. And it's a Boolean. And the default is true. It can be changed at runtime, and it lives on the command line as minus V. And the description is perform verbose logging. So when I read this, my computer program reads this, and it now generates a setting called verbose. And I read it, and I now know there is a setting called verbose. And then when we scroll down, a little bit, it creates a thing called a site, which is a website that is hosted by the Colmo thing, and it too has settings, like it's enabled or disabled. Okay. Let's see if this, yeah, you can actually see this. Call control is the central program, but for ease of use, I've made an alias called WS, web server control, which calls call control with the right settings. So it attaches to the right schema and to the right configuration file. And this is the command you're gonna miss in all other pieces of software you will use from now on. I can do ls on the configuration file. And it will tell me this is the client timeout, these are all my settings, this is everything you can change in this software. So this, you don't have to go to a website to find out what the software claims to have as configuration, only to find out that the setting you were looking for has disappeared in version 1.4. No, this gives you from this version of the software what configuration items are there. And in this case, you can see straight up items like client timeout. On the bigger screen, you could also see the units. Well, not here, apparently. And you can also go... It zooms around a little bit, so sometimes you see something useful. So you can also go down and say WSCTL LS sites, and it will give you for the web server all the sites that are actually defined. And you can then go on and say, well, tell me more about those sites. So if you are lucky enough to be able to read this downstairs, lsds98.nl, you can see the enabled setting, the listen addresses, the path, and the name, and all the settings. So this actually means that you don't have to read the documentation because you can read the configuration schema, which is likely to be more correct than the actual documentation, because the big problem with documentation is that the compiler does not read it. This is how you would start with a minimal configuration. Let's do the zoom thing again. So a minimal configuration is just these two curly braces. And if you then ask the system, show me your actual minimal configuration, you get back those two same curly braces because you have not configured anything. If you ask it for the full config, it will give you a blob of JSON with everything in there, which is sort of fun to have and nice to look at because it gives you all the settings, but it's not that useful as a configuration file itself, because if you ever migrate to a new version, you will have now specified all kinds of defaults that you may not actually be attached to. So a more fun thing is if you now look at give me the minimal config, and now we're going to set verbose as true. That was already the default. So I have now changed the configuration item verbose is true. I say get me the minimal config, nothing comes out, because I'm still at the default config. Now I change verbose to false, I ask for the minimal config again, and I get this little blob. And this is actually the thing you could put in your playbook. You could put in there and say, okay, I have configured everything, this is the minimal configuration, I will just copy that in my playbook. And here I can edit some more settings. So hide server type is true. I set the server name to colmo.org. And if I now ask for the minimal config, you see that it's three lines bigger again. And actually, it's stored on disk as the same file, ws.json, which says these are the three configuration items that you touched. On disk, something interesting happened. Every time I made a change to the configuration, it saved a copy of the configuration file. That means that I have a full history of all the changes that were made to the configuration. Of course, you get that with the playbook as well, because your playbook is in Git, and you get it over there. Secretly, there is a story I can tell you, people still log into servers. They're not supposed to, but they make changes there. And at least when they do, you get this whole trail. And you can just run diff on it and say, well, what changed? Well, this is what changed yesterday. This is in brief how you would start from zero. Add a whole website, gives a bunch of JSON, it's over there. Oh. Yeah. Okay. And you end up, no, not a lot I can do, with a functioning server. So this here is when the server is actually running. So I've started WS, it says verbose is false, we run this website called ds98.nl, and now I can re-alias WSCTL and say now you're going to connect to the running server. So I have the same program that manipulates the stored configuration file as the running server. And I can make changes there. So I can even log into a running server with nothing else and say, tell me about your configuration. And it will tell me. But I can also run at runtime change the verbose setting. Which is very interesting, because that's something you typically want to do during debugging. You don't want to turn the whole server off. It's, well, get me verbose debugging. But of course, now I have this server that is normally be running in an unknown state. Because someone has changed the runtime configuration, there's no trace of that on disk. So with delta config, I can ask the system, give me the difference between your committed configuration and the one you're running right now. And then here it will say, verbose is now true. So that's what your coworker changed after you were on call at 3 a.m. and everything is broken. You can now log in and say, well, I see what you did there. The system also does checking. So if you try to set max connections to 300, it will block that because it says this is not a setting you can change at runtime. Sorry. Or at the top bottom of the screen, if you try to set verbose to something that is not a Boolean, it will actually stop you from doing that. So this is a great way of preventing errors. This is the one I love really best. At the top, let's say I try to set the client timeout to zero, and this is not a defined thing. So zero might mean infinite timeout, it might mean no timeout, I don't know. But in our configuration, there is a rule that in the schema, that whenever something tries to set the timeout to zero, it will reject it. It will say, this is not a valid thing, we don't know what it does, so we're going to stop you from doing it. And at the same way, if I try to set an IP address to something that ends on .321, the system will already reject it and say, look, you're trying to set an IP address to something that is not an IP address. So this is a very nice safety layer that at an early stage prevents you from making impossible configurations. Skip this one. I'll mention it briefly. If you ever want to change a version of the software, and you want to keep your old defaults, you can use this to migrate your full settings to the new settings, and it will tell you what defaults changed under your ass. So some use cases. You have a web server. It's misbehaving all of a sudden. People wonder why. And you log in, and you ask the system, give me your delta config. And there you find that someone changed a setting overnight, and that's what's causing the server to misbehave. Or there's nothing in the runtime configuration is changed, but suddenly nothing worked since yesterday. And you can look at the stored configuration files and see that yesterday at 3 p.m. someone changed a configuration setting, and maybe someone who had ignored the units setting in the configuration help. And finally, this is very briefly, this is what it actually looks like when you're writing a computer program. It says initialize the schema, read the configuration. Then there is a command called declare runtime, which means we are now running. So any changes that are not allowed at runtime are no longer allowed from that point on. And this is how I tie the configuration setting verbose to my own thing verbose, and then I can query it. So this is a very easy thing to do. So what is the relationship between this and automation? The goal of this whole thing is to make the automation easier. So you can go to a server, configure everything there until it is the way you like, and then retrieve the configuration and put that in your playbook. And you can do that in two ways. You could put the call control commands straight into your playbook. So you say, I'm just going to run them on the server, and I'm going to tell the server, I need a website, I need this certificate, I need it on this address, and I need these settings, and my configuration consists of running call control commands on my target server. That's one way of doing it. The other way of doing it is configuring a server until it's happy, and then taking its minimal configuration file and putting that in your playbook, with the hope that that minimal configuration file will actually be portable to slightly newer versions of the software. So this is the relationship between this idea and automation. So this is a strange concept to get, and many people I've explained it to come up with me and say, look, you built a new configuration file parser. But that's exactly not what it is, because the configuration parser libraries that are out there, they will happily parse your configuration file, but they have no opinion on your configuration file. You could put 25-digit IPv6 addresses in there, and they would be fine with it. You could put IPv10 addresses in there, and they would be fine with it. And also, they do not document your configuration file. This gives you a schema that says these are the valid things in the configuration file, and I will offer you a nice API for changing that. The other reaction I get from people is my playbooks are already perfect. And I manipulate these configuration files with my regular expressions, and I'm very good with regular expressions and crimping UTP cables. And these people have a sort of point. If by the time you have sufficient experience making playbooks, you really don't need this help anymore. Also because you don't remember that you spent 10 hours making a playbook for deploying a webmail server. And the third one is the funniest one, and this, I like that reaction best. There are people that tell me, look, Windows invented this stuff already. And turns out that's entirely true. Windows did a super nice job on this. Everything I show here has been invented in 1987. And there is a whole steering board attached to it. If you think the IETF is a difficult thing, you have not met the Web-Based Enterprise Management Consortium, which is when web-based still sounded good. So all this stuff is super old. People realized a very long time ago that you need a schema for a configuration file, since everyone forgot about it already. So what's the status of this? There is a working prototype. So colmo.org is actually served by its own web server. There was a lot of fun, actually, that happened on day two of development. It's a lot of fun to develop on your own working software. You can download it, you can run it, and it's a lot of fun, even as a programmer. Because usually, as a programmer, what you write is get port from configuration file. If no port, port is 80. And whenever you do that, you feel a little bit bad. Because you know you just put 80 in your code, which is an undocumented default. No one knows it's there. And you keep checking that, maybe someone forgot to put this item in the configuration, so I'll put some more defaults in the code here that are also useful. And I'm actually, now that I've developed a web server against a proper configuration file API, I don't do any checking anymore. Because the checking is being done when the configuration file is loaded. And once it's loaded, I know that this is an IP address. And actually, I can just ask for it, and I get the IP address as an IP address. I don't get a string that might be an IP address. No, I get an actual IP address. It's a lot of fun. The quality of the code is just, it will burn your eyes when you read it right now. So the way it tells you that the command is not implemented is by a segmentation fault. Very, very good feedback. And it only works on C++ 2014, and you need Lua and a ton of other dependencies. So the implementation is a lot of fun, but don't go rushing this out into production. Specifically, people ask us, is this what PowerDNS will be doing? And the answer is no, because the idea is not done. And that is actually the whole goal of this presentation. I want people to think about this, and I hope that many of you will disagree or will tell me, look, that's been done, the project is over here, you can download it already, and okay. Also fine. The goal really is to get people hot about the concept. So now what? If you have feelings on this, then please talk to me. If you are a developer, look at the API and say what parts are wrong. If you are an automation person, because this will impact the way you can configure software, please let me know your thoughts. Or again, let me know if you already have something that does this. For every other software user, whenever you install a piece of software, get annoyed that it doesn't offer an LS of the configuration settings and start pushing your software developer friends to say, look, why does your configuration file not come with a schema? Because that's weird. I saw a guy with a Christmas tree, and he said that all software should have schemas. So why doesn't your software? That was it. Thank you.
Fantastic work, Bert.
Yeah.
It fits nicely with a presentation we had at Lekker Weer NL Nog, which would translate as really cool that there's NL Nog again in this beautiful weather, where we covered idempotency of network interfaces. I think this is the next step to an open source router that acts as an actual appliance, because this is the only reason Cisco, Juniper, Nokia, are winning, because there's one text file that actually describes the system, and it's consistent, at least sometimes. but this type of reasoning, this type of research, will bring us there. So I hope that next year we can celebrate the bankruptcy of some of the vendors. To that effect, the first question, please.
Hi, this is Anand Buddhadev from the RIPE NCC. Bert, thank you for this wonderful presentation. I've always been a believer of minimal configuration. Where possible, a lot of our servers, you know, we leave them with the defaults and edit a line here or there, and just leave it exactly as it is, which means it's easy to reproduce. So I love this concept, and I would like to see it go further. Something that occurred to me while I was listening to your presentation is, I was mentioning to a colleague of mine some time ago that a lot of the configuration management systems that we have now, you know, Salt, Ansible, Chef, CF Engine, they all just, they're good at dropping configs into place, but they have no concept of journaling. And what I would like to see is a config management system that preserves a persistent journal. Like, this is a brand new fresh server, and these are all the steps that were taken to bring it to this state, and that journal is something that I can just replay every time against, you know, a fresh new server. And the journal preserves something important, which is removing things. You know, we're all happy to drop files all over the system, but sometimes we also have to remove these files because leaving them around causes,
pain.
Problems. And this is something we're poor at, you know. We add users to the system, but we forget to remove them. Adding is easy, removing is difficult. And this journal, the concept of a journal to configure a system, is something that's sorely missing. And I think that what you've presented is going that way, and I'd like to see it develop further. Thanks.
Thank you. I agree fully. So there is a sort of primordial audit trail in here, but it's very basic, of course. But it would, of course, be lovely to say, look, how did this system get here? And can we just replay it without that mistake in the middle and not create that spare file somewhere? So I agree. Thank you.
Hi, Bert. Thanks. Michiel Appelman, working for one of the potentially bankrupt vendors probably next year. regarding the schema, right, have you looked at other schema, generic schema-based languages or templating schemes, like, for example, Yang models or, God forbid, XSD or something like that?
Yeah, I have. And so the thing is, and I'm trying to find the sample here. So this is, for example, so I have looked at these other things, and many Yang people have spoken to me. And what you see there is a fight for the least common, the smallest common denominator. Where they say, look, we want to pare down this configuration to its basics so that it's generic across multiple vendors, for example. And I have found that most vendors are not actually that on board with that because they want to express their own unique things. And if you put your super special router behind netconf yang, no one will know that it's a super special router because you might not see it. I looked at some other things. I found some previous. There's a project called Open Pegasus, which is something like this. But many of them were very, very committee driven. And I think that if you want to get this right, we should iterate a few times. People should use this and they should say, okay, we got it nearly right. So even during implementing this, for example, I found out that there is a thing as an unset default, which is something you would not have come up with. So it's the default says verbose is true. Okay, that's fine. Now let's say I explicitly put in there verbose is true. That's a different thing because it means I'm attached to the fact that verbose is true. So every configuration item also needs a thing that says, no, this was not the default. The guy wanted it this way. And we should, but you only find that out by doing. And none of the things, for example, one of the things that needs to go in here is comments. Because people would actually put comments in configuration files. Why is verbose set to true? So this needs to have a full comment database as well, which should, by the way, also have a trail to see when people added that. And that's in none of the big systems out there. So I looked into it, and then I thought, I'm going to roll my own.
Okay, thanks.
And that is highly appreciated. Bert, okay,
thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Vielen Dank.